Too few of us are lucky enough to get the opportunity to do what I've just done. As the second leg of a round Australia odyssey, I've just been across the top end of our continent, meeting the hardy folk who live up there in my search for the true character of Australia. As elsewhere in the trip, we skirted the big towns and cities, and up there that was no problem at all. The top end is a region so vast and empty, it swallows its tiny complement of humanity. Even where it's remote, the eastern seaboard of Australia is a populated and an easy place. Two-thirds of us prefer to live there, but we all dream of maybe just once in a lifetime turning our back on the sea and following the sun across the endless and challenging reaches of the Australian continent. Leaving the coast of far north Queensland, my first stop was the small town of Mount Molloy, atop the Great Divide, where, judging by the signs, the publican Mick Dunn is obsessed with dogs.
Everyone comes to town, they bring their dog.
Don't you like dogs?
Problems with dogs lifting their leg on the tables and all that sort of stuff.
So you're a pretty hard man. I mean, you'd throw a dog out, would you?
I would.
Mount Molloy, where dogs are banned and men are on the nose.
As far as we're concerned, there's nothing we can't do, with or without men. Yeah.
Maya and Narelle are single mums who share a house in Main Street, Mount Molloy. A couple of modern girls who lament the lack of real love in small town Australia.
It's hard to find a man that will walk beside you and like take all the responsibilities and everything with you.
Surely we're good for something.
Well, yeah, I mean, you still, even though you can do without men, you still need that emotional and physical contact with the opposite sex.
Sex.
At least I do.
Possibly like the girls, I had stayed too long in Mount Molloy. I flicked Tammy Wynette into the tape deck and headed west, across the Atherton Tableland. Through some of Australia's best farming country, across land rich with deep basalt soil, and on into the sunset. I was heading for the Gulf and a town called Normanton. The Australian outback is home to a thousand broken dreams, grandiose visions of development doomed to wither in this intractable land.
Hello? Hello?
Such a dream was a Normanton railway station, conceived in the 1890s as an impressive northern gateway to Australia. The line was to run more than 1,000 miles to the cities of the south, but it got no further than Croydon, 97 miles away, before the builders ran out of money.
Hello, I'm looking for the station master.
The overworked station master is also the ticket seller and the chief mechanic.
They call it the railway from nowhere to nowhere, but...
His beautiful 50-year-old train had broken down and he had no time to stop for a chat. So I interviewed his boots.
Yeah, that's for sure. You know,
they had delusions of grandeur in those days, did they?
Oh, absolutely. There was a lot of talk about this becoming part of a transcontinent railway. We hear talk of transcontinent railways today. Well, 100 years ago, this was even going to be a part of it.
The vast distances of the far north make a mockery of timetables. I was already days behind and the wet was coming. The giant seasonal rivers of the Gulf might look like they've been dry for a million years, but by late January, they can turn into raging and impassable torrents. On and on, pushing west, chasing the declining sun into those great flat expanses of clay plains and tall grassland known as the Gulf Savannah. We may be running late, but in the glowing afternoon light, I have to leave the car to appreciate this vast emptiness. The only sound, the wind rattling the grasses and sighing over the earth. And so, humbled, I continue, at high speed, merely inching my way across an endless surface towards the Gulf.
What's this? This is about the end of another day. Look at that.
Beautiful, isn't it?
Sitting on the end of the wharf in the fishing port of Corumba with John Woodburn.
And all I woke up with, see this leering animal, trying to have a shot at the back of my sleeping head, and he missed that, put a bullet through my mouth and through my hand. And
John reminds me that for all my reveries about nature and beauty, the top end is still a wild and a dangerous place. 10 years ago, he was almost killed by two armed men for nothing more than some food and supplies.
And he got me again from, 10, 12 feet in the back of the neck. And I just went down, bonk.
Tell me then, John, as a consequence of this, would you be one of the few people up here who believe in John Howard's gun policy?
We're the biggest suckers in the world. That's the another big slice out of the salami sausage, which is our liberties. Every time anything happens, another slice of the salami sausage. And I'm not going to be told by some bloody politician that I'm not fit to. That I'm not fit to have a firearm.
Where brolgas patrol the main street, and where the big tourist attraction is a boar. Indeed, the oldest boar in Australia, or so they told me. Another much photographed point of interest is a cloud formation that sometimes rolls in from the Gulf and is called the Morning Glory. Unfortunately, we didn't get one the day I was there. From Burketown, we push west into the land of the big cattle stations. Back in the east, they measure properties by the acre. Out here, they count them by the square mile. When you look at a sunset here, or you wake up in the morning and you look at a sunrise, how do you feel about this place?
Oh shit, another day.
What about Banjo Patterson? What about the romance of the land?
Oh,
and
that's
the heat haze rising,
Charles, that's
and, the,
all bullshit.
And the wind rustling in the
yes,
leaves.
And the bushfires rushing through your hair.
You say that's all bullshit?
It is absolute crap.
John and Val Dyer own a 1,900 square mile slice of cattle country in the middle of the Northern Territory. It's hot, dusty, scrubby and flat, but they are the lords of all they survey.
It's good to live in a place like this where you can be an individual and you don't have to be a part of a system which is too regulatory in terms of dictating what you do in your life. I mean, we can work extremely hard, but there is some flexibility involved in that as well.
The Dyers raised three children on this property, and against the trend, this efficient couple has paid off the farm in less than 20 years. As for founding an agricultural dynasty, John is again hard-headed and practical.
You'd sell it?
Yes.
Would you sell it to anyone?
Yes.
You'd sell it for the price?
I'd sell it to the highest bidder.
Do you believe what he's saying? I'm not really sure that I do.
No, I think he really loves the land.
Oh, yeah, but you've got to be realistic about it.
You have to make hard business decisions sometimes.
After all that practical realism, what about something completely unreal?
Now we're going to eat some very young buffalo.
Would you believe a five-star French restaurant in the middle of Arnhem Land? On the menu tonight, buffalo au poivre. The recipe, first catch your buffalo. Francois Genet is a French adventurer who has embraced the Australian bush and its traditions. Francois came to the top end 10 years ago, fell in love with Arnhem Land, and built a restaurant and a bush camp here. He caters mainly for European tourists, and last year, on a trip to France, he took with him three elders of the Tillabon tribe, among them his old friend George.
What did you think of the tower?
It's a good look. Too long. Too long?
Too long?
Yeah.
Did you go up to the top?
No. I see it like too far.
Arnhem Land is one of the most remote and unchanging places on Earth. Its beauty is a subtle one, often revealed more in the detail than the big picture.
This is a paradise then?
It is a paradise.
This is rather like it was before Europeans arrived in Australia.
Yes, and it's still like that because no people come in here. What I mean is not any white people come in here for one reason.
Only one crazy Frenchman with a restaurant.
Yes, maybe, yeah.
Mm. It's beautiful, but you knew it would be.
Of course.
Vive la France.
Vive l'Australie and Arnhem Land.
On one hand, the immense distances of Australia have to be experienced by driving across them. But the endless road eventually dulls the senses. It is time for the bird's eye view that creates sense out of dimension and exhilaration out of vastness. By the time I hit the ancient, eroded escarpments of Western Australia's Kimberley, I had become a jaded traveller. After so much outback beauty, I was suffering from scenic overload. And so back down to earth on a river, the Ord, the largest river system in the Kimberley, and the company of a young bloke called Macca.
We have a fabulous environment in Australia, don't we?
Yeah.
But not such a great track record in preserving it.
We've got a hopeless track record.
It's bad, even here?
I believe so, yes. It's something that you tend to worry about future generations, like... If I ever have children, I doubt very much whether they'll ever have any of the experiences that I have.
Still in his 20s, Macca runs his own small tourist business. I fancied a barramundi for dinner, but Macca was more interested in measuring and tagging and putting them back.
He's not big enough.
Oh, no, he's not either.
The waters of the Ord have been harnessed for the Top End's biggest agricultural developments. Macca fears the same environmental damage will occur up here as in the great river systems of the south.
Bit of a kick and he'll be on his way.
We're having fish kills in different parts of the Ord, so it goes to show you that that although other parts of the country may have started to realise the damage that chemicals and other things cause, when you're a little bit further away, these things don't seem to happen quite as quickly.
It's a bit sobering to travel so far and yet find the same problems. Still, sunset on the big river is also a time for counting your blessings.
Macca, do you know how few people in the world actually get to do what they want to do?
No, not too many. A lot of people say that to me. It's what I love doing, but you certainly can become narrow-minded when you're waiting for traffic lights every day and sucking in smog, I suppose.
Journey's end can often be an anticlimax, but the Indian Ocean provides an inspiring finality, reducing the traveller to a mere speck on what felt like the longest and the most deserted beach in the world, where south of Broome, 150 million years before I got here, another traveller passed this way.
Can you show me where he went from here?
Well, we've got quite a distinct track pattern here. Point out where footmarks start from here.
Yeah.
Here's a better size and shape of the footmark over here. Come across over here.
Kevin Garstone, Broome's most enthusiastic dinosaur hunter, tells me it was most likely a 30-ton brontosaurus, five times the weight of an elephant, that left behind these incredible tracks, frozen in rock and time.
So the big question, where was he going?
Well, we had a big debate about this. We reckon he was going that way. Where to? Who knows?
The same direction I will take next week as I travel east, back across the heartland of Australia, some 4,000 kilometres, on the final leg of my journey.
Hello, I'm Sarah Arbo. Thanks for watching 60 Minutes Australia. Subscribe to our channel now for brand new stories and exclusive clips every week. And don't miss out on our extra minutes segments and full episodes of 60 Minutes on 9now.com.au and the 9now app.